Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Thank you.
one who observed the day, observes it in honor of the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord, since he gives thanks to God. While the one who abstains, abstains in honor of the Lord, and gives thanks to God. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God. For it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Said to him,
You wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And you should not, and should you not have mercy on your fellow servant, as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Now, we came together, we served together, we're leaving together. We're here together now. All right. A couple of words I'm going to say. Paula has a couple of words she's going to say. Last week, I was trying to leave you with the word of God, what God wanted to say to you at this time. This week, it's a word for me. I want to tell you what you've given me in this time. You know, if you've done things for a lot of years, most everything I've done for a lot of years now, you get used to them, and sometimes you forget why you're doing what you're doing. Right? Now, when I got a phone call from Bishop Lawrence, he said, David, I need you to work with this church in Walterboro. Well, my first comment was, and I'm sorry, I apologize up front. I said, where's Walterboro? All right? But we discussed it. I talked with Father Bob about it. I spent a lot of time talking to the Lord. There's no two ways about it. My church headquarters up in New York City had told me if I was going to go work with folks such as you, I had to renounce being a priest of the Episcopal Church. Now, I've done that for 40 years. I didn't want I didn't want to be trying to give that up kind of thing. I loved being a priest. It was clear that I was going to give up giving in the Episcopal Church to do that. And basically they said, you'd be kicked out of the Episcopal Church. I said, geez, I've been Episcopal Church for 70 years almost at the time. Didn't like that. I was real upset. But I had to pray about it, think about it. I'm going to tell you I had a problem. And this is what it was. I had turned those two things into idols. And I didn't realize it. Being a priest was all about me, okay? It was about me and not him who serves. It was my calling, my job. It's what I did. And I turned it into an idol. With the church, it was my church. Nobody's going to take my church away from me. I turned it into an idol. You see, I thought it was all about me. About what I want. And so what God does when we have idols, he sometimes takes those idols away from you. And that's what he did. And this is what he gave me. You reminded me who I am supposed to be as a priest. Who I am serving. Alright? It's not about me. It's not about my ego. It is about doing the job that God puts before us. And I had to search through this, and we searched through it together because we were wrestling with it as a parish, too. And I just have to say thank you for that because that helped me reclaim my priesthood. And it's not about me. It's about why God called me and what service he wants for me. That applies to being in the church, too. Sometimes it's hard to hear, but this is not our church. It's God's church. Belongs to God. And when we're here, we're serving God. And he reminded me of that. And if you remember that, then your priorities change. So what you did for me here was helping reclaim my priesthood, reclaim church. As being, I'm God's priest and I'm God's church. And I want to thank you for that. Paul?
Well, when we were informed about Walterboro, we knew that that's what God wanted us both to do. And I said, well, that's okay, but I'm not going to come every week. I'm not going to get involved because I just can't do that. Well, I think that lasted maybe one Sunday. over this week, I kept thinking, well, I should say something from Scripture. After all, I'm his wife, right? And more and more that the same phrase kept coming over from Ecclesiastes, right? Yeah.
You did.
I did good. Always said that. About for everything there is a season. This has been a wonderful season, a blessed season. And I want to thank you, and I think I can say that for both of us. Thank you so much for giving this season with you. And it's hard to go on to another season for us. And maybe for some of you it's a little hard too. But just know there's going to be a wonderful season that's just coming tomorrow for you. And that's how God does that. You're going to be blessed with a wonderful new clergy family. And if you ever want to come by to Buford, come on down. We're at Walterboro Park. We're on a swing. And you will know us. I think they're going to be engraving a swing for us in Buford at the park. So God bless you all. Thank you so much for being such a wonderful family. And we will never forget you. And give us some time. And we'll come back. And you come on down and see us. We love that. God bless you all.
Happy on it. That's our plan.
Yeah.
God has more than once laughed at our plan.
Who knows where
we're going to pop up. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
time of great sickness and mortality. O most mighty and merciful God, in this time of grievous sickness, we plead you for comfort. Deliver us, we beseech you, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use of for their cure. And grant that, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts into that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. For truthfulness in times of worry and anxiety, most loving Father, you will give us to give thanks for all things, to dread nothing but the loss of you, and to cast all our care on the one who cares for us. Preserve us from faithless fears and worldly anxieties, and grant that no clouds of this mortal life may hide from us the light of that love which is immortal, and which you have manifested unto us in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In times of social conflict or unrest, increase, O God, the spirit of neighborliness among us, that in peril we may uphold one another, in suffering tend to one another, and in homelessness, loneliness, or exile befriend one another. Grant us brave and enduring hearts, that we may strengthen one another until the disciplines and testing of these days are ended, and you again give peace in our time. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
For discerning God's will and choosing our next vision, Almighty God, giver of every good gift, look graciously on your church and so guide the minds of those who shall choose a bishop for our diocese, that we shall receive a faithful shepherd who will preach the gospel, care for your people, equip us for ministry, and lead us forth in fulfillment of the great commission through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
That God he loses among the five, we figured we needed new beginnings and a new face in young people. And so here comes new Mars. And so we need to offer him our support in a couple of ways. Most importantly, every time we've gotten a new, I'm gonna preach now. Every time we've gotten a new minister, we've said, my God, he's gonna bring people in, and they're gonna come by the throngs. And then we leave and we put our hands in the pockets and say, man, we saw a little bit of bread. We don't lost as many as we got. And so it's gonna be incumbent on us to really, it's not comfortable. I'm not comfortable asking for money, I'm not comfortable recruiting, but we're gonna have to stir in that role. The second thing is that we need to offer financially. We've always been good at it. We probably need to take that to unprecedented level. Speaking of financially, were it not for this nice tenure that we've had with David and Paul, we would have probably been having this discussion 2 years ago. So we need to look at that and really look at who we are and make a commitment to do that. One thing to mention to you finally is that as a matter in the interest of leadership, the members of the Vestry and Finance Committee have already issued their pledges and made their pledges, and that total is almost $102,000. And so I challenge those who don't give for whatever reason to make a commitment and give, and those who do maybe look to dig a little deeper. This week you'll be met. Mail your pledge packets. There'll be some information about finances in it. Probably more numbers than you'd ever want to see. But if you don't look at one thing, we have a little draft budget in there that it shows it. It's the first time since I've been treasurer we've gone in planning a deficit budget, which we have from short-term reserves to cover, but we're showing a deficit budget. And if you just look at that number, that's kind of, that encapsulates everything. So anyway, thank you for your attention. I know we'll have a successful campaign, and we're going to miss y'all.
Spirit.
they may continue to serve you and give them new adventures in their life. We ask this in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen.
Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and conditions. the blessing of God,